All right, can I have your attention, please? Welcome to UTBA 98, 198. Wow. Class on game theory with applications to Starcraft. Woo! I'd like to start out the class with a quote from Sun Tzu's Art of War. Musical pitches do not exceed 5, yet all their variations cannot be heard. Colors do not exceed 5, yet all their variations cannot be seen. Tastes do not exceed 5, yet all their variations cannot be tasted. The Taoism of battle does not exceed the extraordinary and the orthodox, yet all their variations cannot be exhausted. The extraordinary and the orthodox circle and give birth to each other, as a circle has no beginning. Where's the end? This goes on to say that if we cannot find the beginning or the end of the extraordinary or the orthodox, where is the beginning or end of war? We will take it and say, the number of races in StarCraft does not exceed 3. All their variations cannot be seen. So all of us have a purpose. There's a purpose why you're here. There's a purpose why I'm here. And that is that life is embedded in StarCraft. That StarCraft is a reflection of life and how it should be lived. For instance, the calculations and mathematical modeling we're going to be doing in this class is very applicable to your classes, your businesses in physics, calculus. But we also have to examine the folly of following these calculations, these predictions, to the very end. We have to know the limitations of these calculations. We have to understand information analysis. We of the internet, of course you're familiar with the internet, you're all here. We all have a glut of facts. There are any number of facts on the internet. But it is up to you, it's up to your brain, your analysis, to figure out which of those facts become information for you. Which of those facts are useful, which of those facts are not useful. On the other end of the spectrum, when you do not have enough facts, you must use your inferences to create your own information. In StarCraft, your scouting is never perfect. Your scouting can never get all the information that you need. You don't have map hack on. But you must take what you know about your opponent, what you know about yourself, in order to figure out the status of the game in general. We're going to be discussing economics. We're going to be discussing how to use resources to create more resources, how to operate at the edge of bankruptcy to get the most return, to be daring to the very edge, to know what to you can sacrifice, what you have to value, in order to get the most out of what you have. And finally, this class is about people. We have this game, StarCraft. It's a very limited construct. This construct, however, allows you to view into the mind of someone else. If you can understand yourself, understand your opponent, understand your friend, understand your partner, understand the world around you, that is where your understanding of people from StarCraft, from personalities, comes into play. With that, please allow me to introduce myself. My name is Alan Fang. Some of you might know me better as Nimu. I'm a second year physics student, and I've played StarCraft for about 2.5 years, and about 6 months of those as a pro. During that time, I studied widely, replays, history, and economics. I mean, the thing about history, learning about history, is that you're never actually going to need to know what Leonidas did at Thermopylae, nor what Napoleon did, nor what the Anaconda Plan was. But when you get down to it, you have to understand why those commanders, those generals, why they made the decision that they did, what led them, what facts they used to create what information. A lot of my time was also spent in one-person practice. A figure skater would never go into a competition without knowing the very basics, without knowing the axel, double axel, and can do them 100 times in a row. Neither would a pianist neither would you on your job go to your job unprepared or go to lab. So, one person practice, your single micro by yourself, your macro by yourself. If you don't know those terms, we'll be going over them in the next few weeks. These topics, these processes that you have to get into your fingers, you have to get into your hands, you have to know backwards and forwards. These are very important for you to, in the future. So you have to do one-person practice. I know it's boring, but it works. But finally comes the one-on-one practice. That is when you actually start to try to learn how another person operates, how another person thinks, and that's what you can interpret through this architecture. I mean, I guess in short, I love StarCraft. It's a wonderful game. I'm sure you do too, and I must thank all of you for this outcome. I love StarCraft because it is such a pure expression of human conduct. But also, I must thank all of you, but also certain people who have helped me in this journey so far. It's Sherwin here. Sherwin, aka Yosh, will be delivering some of the lectures, as well as FaZe. FaZe, Anthony. Is Helen here?
No.
All right. Well, Helen helped me greatly through these times. And also Hong Santos, my StarCraft coach from Korea. I'd also like to thank Restitute for helping me over the past year as well. With that, I'd like to turn the floor over to Anthony, who's going to introduce himself a little. Anthony?
I don't have like a super formal thing like he did. So I'm just gonna like keep a short introduction. I'm Anthony. Online, some people know me as FaZe on Team TL. You guys know. I'll be helping Alan teach his course. And a little background about me: I'm a third year EEK student. I was surprised. I played StarCraft on and off for about 7 years. I just really love the game, and like I probably watched like every single like Korean VOD for like the last like 2 years. It's like every single one. I'm like not kidding. Well, I mean, well, you know, for the Star League and Pro League, it's not really. Okay. Anyway, all right. So that's me. I'll probably be talking on a little more today and more on a later day. All right. So I'll turn it over to Sherwin, who should introduce himself too.
Alright, wow. My name is Sherwin Mabat. My nickname online is Yosh, or Yosh. And originally, when I was helping Alan actually decide on this course, it was like maybe 6 months ago or a year, I didn't remember. It was just an idea back then. And last semester when we were coming around to it, it was almost too late. We contacted some professors, and basically the whole process was delayed with the decal organization. And luckily Alan, he really jump-started at the semester, and we thought, how many were people? 15?
The first two rows.
Yeah, first two rows. And those were mostly the people that we had maybe land before or knew. But this is amazing. So right now I work in an investment bank in Palo Alto. I graduated last year, business major. And so seeing this turnout, if at least like 80% of you come every week, then I will do my best to make it here every week as well. I've been playing StarCraft for like 10 years, so you could say I'm a StarCraft-aholic. And I haven't played in about 2 months because I've been very busy, but I still follow it. I talk to Alan and Anthony all the time about the game and of all the developments on many sites. So what I want to bring here is basically I just want to empty all the knowledge that I have, because like maybe all sports, all players that play sports, you get to a point where you stop becoming a player and you enter the coaching phase, right? So I want to get all the history, all the old strategies, the new strategies, how to approach the game, improve your game sense. It's very important. And reading your opponents at all times. So I've played many best of three, best of five, best of seven series at World Cyber Games and other tournaments offline and online. So that is what I want to get across. So it doesn't matter where you are in the game. You can be a total newbie that wants to learn the game or just wants to understand it better, or you can follow the game really closely, like we do, and get a better understanding of it. So Alan made a really good point at the beginning that there was never an end to the war. So it's very applicable to the game that it's a really easy game to learn, but very, very difficult to master. So, you know, I played 10 years. I'm nowhere near the top, and best I've done is beaten like class pro gamers, and on occasion A class pro gamers back like 5-6 years ago. You may have heard of Boxer and Nada and Yellow, and these guys still, you know, they've won many tournaments, and they've won many OSLs, and they are no doubt, you know, going to go in the Hall of Fame if there is one. But they still don't win consistently. You know, why is that? So there are just so many very, very, very good players right now. And there have been in the past, and maybe now it's the most difficult of the StarCraft eras with, you know, Flash and Fantasy now. It's ridiculous. So, as I was saying, you can be on the anywhere on the spectrum. You can be, you can be like a D player, as I reference Ico here, or C or B or, you know, B plus A. But if you want to improve, you know, your game sense, you're going to do that here. If you want to improve your hand speed, your APM, then you're definitely going to do that here. It just takes repetition and a good approach to the game. And if there's one piece of advice that you should always remember, and you know it's applicable to StarCraft and applicable to life, but you have to take losing in stride, right? So you're going to lose. You know, just think of all the pro gamers that have just been demolished on stage. You know, 3-0, 5-0. You know, Yellow, right? So you have to take losing in stride, and you're just going to get better, right? Everybody's done it, and it just takes practice, right? It's a craft, right? So you just have to practice and get better at it. And if you're able to take away an ounce of every game you play, right? Just take a moment after the game is over, whether you win or lose, right? Just take a moment to think about the game. What happened in the game? What was the main point that happened, right? It could have been on your side, could have been on your opponent's side, his mistake, your mistake, whatever. You just got to think about it and analyze the situation. Be like, okay, wow, I shouldn't have made this mistake. Okay, next game I'm not going to make the same mistake, right? So you just got to be patient and take losing in stride. And hopefully get a lot of lap time and get to play a lot of practice games and whatnot and improve. So yeah, Alan, so that's right. Nice to you.
Thank you, sure.
Sure.
I don't know what you guys have heard so far about this class, but I must emphasize that this is a class you can fail. So what happened to the syllabi that I brought? Are they still outside?
You can use this one.
I have one, but there's 60 outside. What happened to the rest of it? Did you guys get syllabi? Okay. Can you pass out as many syllabi as you can? Just if you can't follow with it, it's also online at berkeleystarcraft.com. By the way, berkeleystarcraft.com is a site made by my webmaster, Code. Code. And you'll be able to see. You'll be finding your homework there. You'll be finding the syllabus there, and everything else, and updates or anything. But here we go. The syllabus. The grading for this class will consist of. Weekly homework, I'm sorry, this is incorrect. Weekly homework is 20, homework and replay is going to be 40%. Attendance is going to be 20%, and final project is going to be 40%. I'll go into over more of this as we go on. You guys can read, or if you can't read right now, you can read later. So I'm going to go over some main points. I'd like to emphasize something that you might not have heard over the course of your last 15 years of school. Believe me, there are dumb questions and people do ask them. One of my friends once asked me, when should you build a pylon? At 7.5 or 8.25? This is a very valid question. I mean, if you're asking a question about how to make the game faster, how to make yourself faster. But yet, by asking that question, you show that you don't understand why you're building that pylon. Is a pylon for supply or gates or whatever? So you have to understand why. You have to expect an answer. You have to argue your hypothesis before you ask any question. Okay, going on, course objectives. This class is not to make your StarCraft directly better. you can't take this class, go from your D or D minus to a D plus, okay? That's not gonna happen. This class is for better analysis, to understand the game better, to understand the deepness of StarCraft, everything you have to analyze in StarCraft better. Our mathematical models, they aren't meant to do differential equations in the middle of the game. You can't be like, let me pause for a second, I'll be back in half an hour, I'll do the differential equation for a while. You can't do that. But what we can do is we can understand trends. We can understand how the game flows through this class, and that's what we hope to work on. Also, prerequisites for this class. Like Sherman said, this class is open to complete noobs or the highest pros, because we're looking at it from a whole different perspective. However, I must ask everyone to have an open and analytic mind when coming to this. And also, please have a decent background in math, because the stuff you're doing is not going to be easy. So yeah.
Oh, and please have access to a computer where you can play StarCraft on, because we aren't going to provide like CDs to everyone who needs. Oh, I need reward. Yeah, okay.
It's $10 if you can't have it.
It's $4 at g2buy.com.
Anything else,
Anthony?
Alright. So as far as the class, there's three parts of the class. One is the homework. The homework will be posted online. Another is a lecture. You're all here right now. That's excellent. And finally is the reading. There's a reader for this class. It's the Theory of StarCraft. Right here. It's available as ZZ copy over at the alleyway where the yogurt shop is.
Yogurt park
is.
Saylor Lane on
South Side. Saylor Lane, right next to Ned's. So if you want to buy books, go to Ned's, then go to ZZ copy. See, the reason why there's three parts to this class, homework, lecture, and the reader, is that I don't want to be one of those people who read to you what the text says, and then leave you with that, and then the homework is just repetition. I want to be someone who can challenge you in each aspect. I want to do things in class that you can't do while reading a book. Okay, next, if you look around, this class is kind of full. So we are limited to 62 admissions only. So who gets into this class will be dependent on your little note cards. I hope you all brought something to write with and to write on the note cards. Course workload. There is homework every week. The homework will be posted online and is due at the beginning of each lecture on this desk right here. If you find that the homework is very difficult, consider coming to class. And also, the course outline. In all of your classes, you build on what you learn every week. So we have to come to here, but we don't have a set structure here of what to learn, what to do each week. So we have the following. Well, what does anyone know? We're getting a little ahead of ourselves. So does anyone know what is the most basic topic in StarCraft? Anyone?
That it requires more minerals?
Good one. No, actually, you don't have to have minerals to live. What do you have to live in StarCraft?
Buildings!
You have lost all your buildings, you lose. So the most basic building block of StarCraft will be our buildings. But, with the exception of Terran, buildings don't move, okay? So, without movement, you cannot effect change. What you need, then, but what do you do with these units? It's a very big problem. If you're the manager of a construction site, you have a guy swinging your crane around, you have a couple guys doing sit-ups, and you have a couple guys carrying like logs back and forth. They're not doing much. And so if you don't have your workers, you don't have your units, you don't have your fighters doing anything in StarCraft, you're wasting time. So we have to discuss what to do with your unit, and that comes in the form of micro and army management. Finally, how do you create these units? Through macro management, through production facilities, production buildings, etc. Now, these are only the most basic topics. We've only covered what doesn't move and what moves. So how do you get into someone's head? How do you learn more about them? Well, With micro alone, you learn to harass.
Not sexual. Starcraft.
Between your micro and your units, you can scout, so to speak. You can figure out what's going on in your opponent's base. And there's a topic of attention. How can you put more attention into the game? Where do you divide your attention? Where do you divide your resources? If you're the CEO of Ford right now, what do you save and what do you let go? You have to save $4.9 billion next year. What do you do? We'll be doing some of that here, just not with money or stuff, but we'll be doing that with your attention. Finally, economics. Economics will apply to buildings, macro, and the flow of the game, how you progress through the game. Using your resources, using your current resources to make more resources. And finally, with these topics that you can, that to get into someone's head, finally we get into the highest tier of study, and that is to use what you know about your opponent to create something completely new to work your opponent over, to work on your opponent, so to speak. So we start with that, we have deception. So between your scouting and your thinking, your analysis, you have your deception. And also, between your economics and your scouting, you have your timing. And with those down, you have your mind games. So these are, 13 topics that we're going to be talking about this semester. I think one of them a week. We might spill over or catch up behind afterwards.
So can I interrupt you?
Of course.
Hi. So I just thought I'd introduce myself. So I'm John Morgan, and I'm a professor here in the business school. I teach game theory. And I am the official sponsor for this class. I spoke to Alan. So in my misspent youth, I've spent a lot of time playing video games of various sorts. So naturally, I was intrigued and excited about the topic and thought it would be a good excuse for applied research on my part. But anyway, I've spoken to Alan about the structure of the course, the syllabus, and the topics. And I'm absolutely confident that you're going to have a great experience, and we're going to be in touch throughout the semester. So I don't want to take up any more of your time other than to wish you the best of luck on an exciting journey. And I'm just delighted. I mean, the turnout, this is just fantastic. It's super. All right.
Thank you for joining us. Finally, at the end of our syllabus, we have our final project. So at the beginning, at the very beginning, I alluded to a purpose for all of us. There's a purpose for me, there's a purpose for you. And also, I feel that everyone should give back to the community that's given them so much. I hope that this class is my way of giving back to the StarCraft community, which has taught me. Now you have to make some contribution to the StarCraft community as well as part of this class. Without ongoing study, without ongoing research, without ongoing papers, there never would be any advancement. So, with the final project, we're gonna look for something new. Whether you want to create a new model, a new formula, something new to analyze your games. Whether you want to create a new strategy or define the game better. There's one topic I'm very interested in, and that's just exactly how carriers, let's say, attack. And if you really want to study that, you can. And you can put it in a paper, you can publish it on either Team Liquid or GhostToGamers.net, and you'll be criticized, your peers will criticize you, and as they examine your work. This is the end result of all our studies. You in chemistry, business, physics, liberal arts, film studies. You all must come up with something new, something exciting to give to the community. This is our way of doing that.
So yeah, we'll elaborate on this as it gets closer to the date, because right now he's saying a lot, and you're probably thinking like, oh man, this is like, yeah. Basically, that's what I thought when he was crazy when he said that. But anyway, yeah, so we'll elaborate more on this as we get closer to like the middle of the course, because that's when we'll have officially taught you all these concepts.
Right. So like Anthony said, without some of these topics, you won't know how to start on your project. So as we get further into it, you have a better understanding of what you want to do, what you want to learn. So it seems like I have a little extra time, so we can go over the history of StarCraft in development, how it got to be so big, how it was so successful. So StarCraft, the original Brood War, the original StarCraft, Vanilla, was announced in 1995 with its eventual release in 1997. You notice that this is a 2-year development period. It is quite long considering video games. And during this time, part of its success was because it took so much, took so many comments from the community abroad. It asked people what they wanted. To give you a sense of what StarCraft used to look like, we have this. This is the StarCraft Alpha. We have this Overlord here that has 4 damage.
How unbalanced.
But since then, they've taken suggestions from people like yourselves, people in the StarCraft community, people who know what they want, who know what they want to see in the game. And they refined it, they toned down the colors, they made it more balanced, they made it faster, into something like what we have today. These pictures that you see right here, these are StarCraft beta units. Some of these are very clearly recognizable. Like, what's this? Scout, right. What's that? Actually, back then they had a gun, just so you guys know. Some of them you might not know, something like this perhaps.
Spire.
It's a spire. It's not exactly what we see today, but it's right there. So, back with StarCraft beta, they tried to make everything the best they can. They still use the old Warcraft 2 engine, but they upped the graphics, they upped the sprites, they had made it so that you can max out with more sprites, so more things can fire at the same time, have more things on the map, be more exciting game.
Actually, I also want to say something about that. Believe it or not, even though they upgraded, they increased the number of sprites. I've played several games, and I'm sure some of you guys have just played around, that there may come a point in the time, usually in late game, where there aren't enough sprites for all your units to actually be functioning correctly. So, Goliaths, Valkyries.
Valkyries is special.
Yeah, it's really annoying, especially if you're in a serious game and you spent like thousands of minerals, resources on them, and they just die, right? So.
you all laugh at me, right? Who has a Windows 95 computer? Who has 10 times more computer speed than that? 90 megahertz. Exactly. So I think another part of the game that makes it so widespread, so great, is Blizzard's tradition of making it such low specs. This game came out in 97. So 95 had been out for a while. So imagine if they released it soon after 95. Who with 95, the only people with 95 would have been able to play the game. But since its development period was so long, which might have been a good thing in this case, more people would have been able to be exposed to the game. It doesn't ask for much, 90 megahertz, 16 bits, megabytes of RAM, and CD-ROM. Those are all basic things that computers back then very commonly had. So you don't need your fancy graphics card with 8800 GT or whatever to play StarCraft 1, Brood War, or Brood War. All you need are the bare basics. Now, who here has heard of the country called South Korea? This is a country that has caught on to StarCraft and latched onto it with their teeth.
Yeah.
Although that's not entirely by coincidence. The StarCraft, StarCraft government. The South Korean government spent $1.85 billion on broadband technologies spent in the form of subsidies to make telecom companies spend more to give consumers cheaper resources. That is how every teenager and their mother got broadband, like back in like 2000 or 2001, when it was unheard of here. And as evidence of that, there's 20,000 PC cafes in South Korea, and this was like 2 years ago. And their average rate is about 1,000 won per hour, and that's about a dollar. By comparison, a relatively cheap computer cafe in the United States is like $6 an hour. So you can make the comparison there. And also, as proof that the telecom community, telecom companies did use that money, and that it did advance StarCraft considerably, SK Telecom, which is a sponsor for SKT T1, the pro gaming team, grew into one of the best pro gaming and with one of the highest win ratios in all of the pro gaming leagues. But StarCraft isn't confined entirely just to South Korea. It was developed here in Irvine. It is a United States game. Who here's from Irvine? Well, congratulations to your city. So, back in 95, internet speeds were doubling at the rate about once every 6 months. If anyone can still remember back to 1995, you had AOL, you had the stupid annoying voice that told you, you have mail. But imagine playing StarCraft with that kind of internet. So, the extended development time, again, worked to StarCraft's benefit, because once it came out, it immediately became a hit, and people could play it online over BNet. Granted, it was terribly imbalanced, and there were hackers everywhere back then, but it was still a way for people to interact. Multiplayer gaming over the internet was unheard of back then, almost. But StarCraft really caught on to that, and that's why it expanded to one of the games today. I mean, another big thing is that Blizzard has been continually patching it. We're up to 1.16 now, and has been making it a better and more balanced game. Just some statistics. In 1987, 36.6% households owned a computer with only 18% online. That grew to an impressive 41% of households with internet in 2000. So you can imagine what kind of user base StarCraft gained during those years. This is a graph of internet U.S. internet growth speeds. That's the best I could find, but the most important one is this green line right here. You can see that the green line demonstrates the total capacity of all the internet in the United States. I know it sounds fancy, but it's just the amount of internet in the United States. And you can see that with 95, all before as well, but especially 95, it started on a constantly growing and very strong trend. So imagine 2 years later, we have 1997 pinpointed on here, it has grown 10 times than 95. So imagine how much better, how much easier StarCraft got to play with, 10 times more internet, so to speak. So, as a little note, just before our break, I'd like to comment on what I would like you to write on your little note cards that everyone has. You notice that this is a very large class, and not everyone's going to get in. There are going to be exactly 62 people in this class. And we're looking for some things. First of all, your name is great. We'll need the highest math class you've taken. For those of you who've read the syllabus, we'll be dealing with concepts in derivatives, calculus, analytic geometry, and differential equations. This is not easy, it's not for weak hearted, so consider that when you're taking this class. Also consider you might fail. As far as your gaming history goes, if you're great, you can tell us what your APM is. If you do not know what your APM is, then right, I do not know. You won't be penalized for that, but we just need to know what the makeup of the class is. And please don't exaggerate. None of you have 400 APM, I know that. What your ICOP level is. Again, if you don't know what your ICOP level is, I don't know. And please don't exaggerate again, because...
Don't extrapolate, so you guys who played like 5 games on like 5-0, dude, A+, right there. You know, okay, don't extrapolate, I know everyone does this. So if you're C-, you're C-. You're not B+.
Because if you're B+, we'll know who you are. Also, but most importantly, out of all this, we see lots of faces. You all come from very different backgrounds, you all play different mounts, but you all love StarCraft. I want you to tell me why. Why you are here right now, why you want to take this class, okay?
That's like the most important thing for, or second most important thing for you guys. First important thing is, your email probably so we can find that. Yeah, but that's the same most important thing for you guys.
So I think we'll stop it right here. We can take a short break. We'll meet again in 10 minutes. Okay, before, you're going to get up, take a break or whatever, but please take all your stuff. When you sit back down again, I want Terrence in this section, in this section, and Zerg in this section, okay? Random state at the very front. Alright. Thanks again. Does everyone have their note card right here? No one gets into class without the note card there. Okay. I think there's some stuff I've forgotten to mention. One is lab. Lab will be in the bottom of Moffitt. It'll be on the first floor where there's plenty of plugs, lots of space, lots of light, and we'll all have lots of fun. Part of your weekly homework assignment is two replays, okay? Two replays sent to which email again, Anthony?
It's called StarcraftDecal@gmail.com.
StarcraftDecal@gmail.com.
And tomorrow we'll upload a new version of the syllabus with all these changes like reflected. But right now it's not on the syllabus right now, but so tomorrow there's gonna be a new version of the syllabus. So tomorrow after let's say 10 AM.
Are we planning to use Air Bears?
Yes.
Is that gonna work?
Yes, definitely. Okay. Air Bears is one of the best routers in the world. As long as we're all within Air Bears, but preferably in Moffitt, as long as we're all within Air Bears, we can even use UDP setting. Otherwise, we can use ICOP.
UDP.
Also, someone really dear to me, I forgot just a while ago, who I forgot to thank. If Lore would stand up, please. Lore, thank you. Next, about the homework. I'd like to elaborate a little on the homework since didn't talk too much about it earlier. There's a homework that's going to be posted on the website, berkeleystarcraft.com, and every week it's going to be under homework. This is week one, so if you go home tonight and you go on berkeleystarcraft.com and you click homework one, you'll see a PDF. This PDF will tell you what to do and what to write to turn into class the beginning of next week. There will be homework due every week, and it's due on the table at the beginning of class. Sherman, are we ready, or is this thing blank?
Oh, I need to get there.
We're getting there.
We have some nice pictures. Yeah.
I had a question about webcasting. Is lectures, will lectures always be webcasted?
Well, actually, let's have a question. GamePro, that's you, right? Do you think you'll be coming in the future weeks to webcast?
Yes.
Okay. if they don't come, I plan on casting some of this myself, but we don't want to give everything away now, do we? Otherwise, who's going to come in next semester? So that's going to be that. Other questions? Yes.
Are you going to be posting your PowerPoints online as well?
The PowerPoints will not be posted online. There's nothing significant in them except pictures. Other questions?
Are you going to post getting into the class, the 62 students?
That's the tough question, huh? I will not be posting them. I will not be saying publicly who gets in and who does not. However, I will be giving everyone who does get in an email by next Thursday. So if you don't get an email,
this class by next Monday, so you guys don't.
This class will almost definitely be available next semester as well. So we could, if this class is going to be available next semester, we could do sort of like a first come first serve based on whoever doesn't get in this time. well.
Yeah, that's definitely right. We're going to be having this class again, and those of you who don't get in this semester will have some more priority next semester. We'll see how dedicated you are. We'll see you coming every semester. That'd be great. Yes?
People who don't get in class, can they still come in?
Yes, that's a great question. There's many of you who aren't in the class, many of you who have graduated, high schoolers, alumni from other schools. All right? So all of you are welcome. Actually, I think the crowd's died down a little, so there are empty seats. We'd be more than happy to have all of you. We'd be happy to have your discussion, and we'll be happy to see you. All right, so...
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Will the people getting, will they be chosen at random, or do some people have priority, or what? Is it completely red?
Second most important question for you guys on number.
You know, you wrote under the last one, you wrote why. Everyone wrote why, I hope. I hope you wrote something really spectacular. Alright.
Why? Why not?
Now, what's your name? What's your name?
David.
David. Last name?
Lee.
David Lee.
What?
Excellent.
You're in?
You're in. Oh my god, I just wanted to audit this honestly. Alright, so let's take a trip down memory lane to the battles of Starcraft history. Sherwin!
Okay, so is everybody situated by their race? By their Starcraft race? So like, Sherwin is Zerg. Now, are you guys random on
here? Yeah.
Hey, random plays. So there's like a lot of StarCraft history, and like I said, there's been a lot of successful players. And so I want to start off by asking a couple questions and just gauge how much you guys know about StarCraft. So who started playing this game like within the past, or just know about it within the past 2 or 3 years? Okay, and who has played over like 7 years? You know, on and off. Okay, so do you guys know of a guy by the name of Emil Wan?
Yeah.
Boxer, Yi Sun Sol? Nada, I think, right?
Yeah.
Or Yellow, some of the really old programmers. So StarCraft back, StarCraft didn't really start, it didn't, pro game that started until Brood War came out. That was, I think, in 1998. Before then, nobody really cared, and the game was terrible. It was imbalanced, like Terran sucked, and no medics, you know. So, but
Warpole is like the best build.
Yeah,
Warpole is 50 minerals, man.
That's one reason why there were so many Zerg players back in 1999, and on the old ladders like Game I. Which was, in my opinion, the best ladder of all time. A lot of pros used to play there, and after it was shut down because it was a private server, there really wasn't another ladder comparable to it, based on like pro gamer activity. But like I said, Brood War really started pro gaming, and I think StarCraft was the first game that launched this whole industry as well. And then Counter-Strike closely followed behind. Along with in the World Cyber Games. So here are just some ladders. How many of you play on ICA or know about ICA? Okay. Before ICA, there was another ladder that was very similar to it, PGT, and it was a little weaker version of the ladder. And nowadays, I think there are a lot of good pro gamers that come on early in the season, sometimes late in the season too, and you can usually pick them off, like 88-0 or whatever. They're really good. So let's start here. So these guys are like the most popular guy. Well, except for that guy at the bottom, he's not a Korean. He was really popular too. These guys are like Chick Magnus in Korea, and they get swarmed all the time. They have huge fan bases. So I want to start by going back to 1999 when I think, you don't have a name listed here that I wanted to mention, but it's okay. I think pro gaming exploded with the first match. I don't know if any of you recall or followed it back then, but there was a foreigner by the name of GG99 Slayer. Do you guys know about him? You've never heard of him? Oh, way before your time, okay. Slayer, Norwegian, and he was a very good sort of tournament player. He played TVP, TVZ, and ZBT. So he was invited through a tournament, KBK, or it may have been an exhibition against Boxer in Korea. And this is one of the first huge stadium matches. They were both in boots on a huge stage, kind of head-to-head boots, and so many people in the stands. And this was like going to be huge for pro gaming, because if Slayer won, then it would have expanded pro gaming to you know, the entire world. And if Boxer won, then it would have been huge in Korea, and you can pretty much tell who won that match. And it was just obliteration. It was 3-0. It was Terran versus Zerg all three times, and Boxer just dominated, and that's soon why there are so many Terrans in Korea. And after that, Slayer didn't play too much, but it really did actually open the doors for foreigners as well. So Boxer was really, you know, that's why they call him the Emperor, because he was there from the beginning. He's always been dominant. He's always had a really aggressive style. Even today, if you watch him, you know, he went in the army for 2 years, came back. He was still a decent player, and he does crazy stuff, crazy strats. Like, you know, he proxies in the center of the map, just ridiculous with like a one barrack skill. But that's part of his nature. He wasn't that, he didn't used to be actually that aggressive and crazy before. He used to be more by the book, just really solid technical skills. And nowadays, I think because he's off his game a little bit, you know, he took so much time off in the army, even though he was still playing there. they made a pro team for him in the army, so that's pretty sweet. But you know, that's why he reverts to so many bold strategies. But you know, you've got Yellow team around. Maybe a year later, the first, not the first big Zerg player, Go Rush was actually the first big Zerg. He won 2000 WCG, which wasn't the real first one. It was an inaugural one, a smaller tournament. But then Yellow came around, and he was the basically the best second place player. I think still to this day, like, you have to feel sorry for the guy, because he made it all the way to the finals and all the tournaments, only to lose the Boxer in the end, right? And it wasn't always 3-0. You know, he had some close ones, 3-2 as well. But it's, there are so many Terran players that came into the scene because Boxer just kept, you know, being the best Zerg player out there, and that gave a lot of hope to future Terran players. And you know, with the additions of, I should mention, patch 1.08, which was around 2001. No, 1999, 2000, I believe. It was a long time ago. Made the dropship faster, actually made Goliaths useful with their increased ground-to-air attack and a lot of other good additions to the game. And that just made Boxer even more dominant. So another nickname for him is the dropship user, because he's so good with the dropships. And hopefully we can link you guys to some YouTube clips or something of his amazing dropship skills, where he, you know, he would take two tanks in a dropship, drop one on a cliff, pick it back up before the other ranged unit's particle or whatever, its missile would reach the tank, drop it again, pick it up, drop it again, pick it up, and it's really a headache, and it's one of the reasons why I became a Terran player, too, so.
Yeah, so quick poll, actually. Who plays, out of the Terran people, who plays Terran because of Boxer?
Yeah.
And I'm a Terran player, too, and I'd say I play Terran because of Boxer.
So Boxer, he was just destroying everybody in all the tournaments until Garimto came along. Very, very good Protoss player. And he basically stopped Boxer's reign. He beat him 3-2, I believe, in a Star League. And that started this whole Legend of the Fall theory, where Protoss always wins the Fall Star League. No matter, you know, what happens earlier in the year. So, these three, Yellow, Boxer, and Grimto, are really the old three. The Marine as well used to be a very good old school Terran player. He became a commentator, as did Grimto for a while, and then he came back a few years ago, not a few years ago, but maybe 1 year ago. He played one Pro League game and then decided to quit again. So, and so this spurred interest in the foreign community for people to come and try player in Korea. And so the first one was Guillaume Patry, aka Gur, and he was from Canada, went to Korea through KBK tournament, won a Star League there, and did very well. He was there for a few years, put up some good results in his pro team, and then went on to other things. So made way for Elke in the bottom right, Frenchman, and he went in there as well. And as we go through these players, no American, not American, but no foreigner ever really made it big in Korea. A few won a lot of television matches, but I don't think they ever came close to winning a Star League. So some of the other players that really deserve mention, Nada, who I think is one of the best Turnverse Zerg players, even though he's known for his Turnverse Protoss as well. And I believe he was given his nickname Tornado Turn because he was able to create so many units so quickly. And his micromanagement is unbelievable. If you find a video of Nada playing Turnverse Zerg, it's just really a treat to watch. Not of like the past last year, looked like 2-3 years ago when it was more in his prime. But it's really good. And a lot of, I'm sure a lot of upper Terran players, higher Terran players, foreigners and Koreans always look to Nada because his micromanagement and his APM is ridiculous. It's like 450, 400, 450. And he spends his money. He has very good macro along with his micro. So, Cho Jaeja, I used to call him, a Zerg player, who was always kind of in the same boat as Yellow. I'm not sure if he won a Star League, so I have to reference you at the end of that one.
He did.
He did? So, obviously the fact that I don't really remember it too well, he didn't make it too big. But he's always been a very, very good practice partner for the other players as well. And I think one of the most liked players, not just by Terran players, but everybody, not the people that he beats, but Zelos, who is just really technically skilled, is so good in the game, and hopefully we can get some replays or VODs of him and we can show you examples, but this guy's like the quietest guy, I think, based on videos and pictures I've seen. He's quiet, he never talks, he never makes any facial expressions except for that one. and he's like a silent killer, so he's a very good player. So now moving forward a little bit, Kingdom was here from maybe 2000, but I don't think he made it big until just a few years ago, along with Nalra. Nalra really turned, or took Protoss versus Zerg in a new direction. Before, it was mostly like, one gate, one base Protoss, and, play 10 minutes and then get owned by Zerg, stand all over the place. And he came up with a new style, using Weavers really well on some maps. Weavers and Shuttles along with Corsairs, along with his cannons. Lots of cannons. Cannons are really good. And Boxer's protege, I Love OOV. He was on SK Telecom with Boxer, learning from him from the very beginning, and that's why he became so dominant. Oh, it's too bad that the stats on this picture got cut off, but because for the 73 games played, so that was the earliest career, and then the wins are right next to it. But I Love OOV, Cheater Terran, they still call him because he always had more units than you expect. So doesn't matter when a Protoss or Zerg would attack him, but he'd always have more units. So his macro is very, very strong. So he'll be one of the players that we might reference for learning exactly the timing of his macro, expanding and so forth. And I think he's a coach now. He's the coach of SK Telecom. So these are newer generation, I think.
there's a nickname for like Razor.
So July Zerg, in my opinion, is always one of the players that has played a very solid game and is able to beat any opponent on any day because he just plays a very solid style. And I've seen him play some really low macro games, but he's always played very well, and he's still around today. I think for Is he on STX right now?
Yeah,
STX. And he was traded there, actually. So he's on a good team now, along with, along with Hwasim and others. Anytime, another very good Protoss who I think continued that Legend of the Fall trend, who actually, you know, saddened me a lot because he kept killing Terrans and throwing his Terran. And so I'd always be afraid to watch the VODs of how the finals came out because he'd always win 3-0 or 3-1 in Terran or Protoss versus Terran. So I would definitely say that his best matchup is Protoss versus Terran. And then probably Protoss versus Protoss behind. But I think a lot of fans and players' favorite is Savior, because he put a stop to, or actually he was, he kind of revolutionized Zerg. He was a very good player and still a very strong player. And I don't know why they call him the Maestro. Is it just because
his
name
is Majin? It's M-A-E.
Yeah.
And then he's just like the bone drawn, like the like. He's really good.
That's
a problem. Call him the Maestro.
Star. Savior was playing very well, and he kind of had a year, I believe, like Boxer did, back in 2001. But basically, BC put an end to that, and it was just so shocking because Bisu, and I mentioned that Nalra took it a step further, took Protoss Berserk a step further with his further play, but Bisu took it one step further and made the games longer. He did an early expand versus Zerg, which people thought was crazy back then. You know, Zerg should be expanding, Protoss should be expanding against Zerg, and he's one of the main reasons why the evolution of StarCraft has gone from offense to defense, at least at the beginning of the games. Not only is he good Protoss versus Zerg, but he's good Protoss versus Terran as well. Although he's had some difficulty versus that guy at the bottom in the past. And I know a lot of people like Stork, and you know, Stork has also had a very good Protoss versus Terran. And but you know, there have been other new players that have really taken the reign, and Flash, J-Dong, feel they have a chance to make it big in Korea because this is, you know, always at the beginning of StarCraft, the gap was so big. The gap was smallest when Slayer played Boxer. But then the gap widened, and, you know, for good reasons, too. It's a job for them. You know, these guys play 10 hours a day plus against the best players. We play maybe 2-3 hours. Okay, who are we kidding? 6-7 hours. High cup or whatever. But you got to remember, we're still playing people that aren't anywhere near their level. It'll get you up there, but it's a lot slower, right? They make it up there a lot faster, and they stay up there faster or longer, and it takes a lot longer. So I believe the gap was smallest back then. It widened, and now it's closing again, but it's tough to say if foreigners will ever be able to play on an equal ground as Koreans. One thing that is also important to remember is that they have the leagues going on over there 24/7. They have two television stations that broadcast games nonstop. So I believe these television stations are still broadcast online, so we will give you the links to them if you so wish. But it's educational and it's a learning tool for them 24/7. It's entertainment. So we don't have any leagues here. We have an iCup ladder, which is good. But we had the Team Liquid League a while ago, and we have our frequent tournaments here and there, but it's nowhere near the exposure, prize money, stature of them. So I believe 6 months ago, maybe 9 months ago, Idra went to Korea. He's a Terran player from the USA. He's in Korea right now for playing with Team CJ. And so he's playing with Zelos and Dark Elf.
Not Zelos anymore.
Really? He's not CJ?
Yeah.
Quit?
I think Zelos either like went to the army or something.
Oh no. But there are still other good players. C Shield. No, he's on NBC Games, so he's also a good player. But it just goes to show that it's really, really difficult to make it when you go to Korea. And just a little piece of information, that when you go to Korea, I think it's been the trend pretty much for any foreigner, you're basically like a servant when you go there for the first 6 months until you prove yourself. You're scrubbing the toilets. You are mopping the floors. It's basically like a hierarchy, right? New players will do the same thing until they prove that they're worthy of being on the team, worthy of representing the team on television. And remember that these teams, they have team matches that's called Pro League. And they play best of five, and they send out one player, and then the other team sends out a player, and it's one versus one, and they have another one versus one, and so forth. And if they screw one of these up, then it's a big deal for them, because they can't make it into the playoffs, and they might lose their sponsorship. Because they don't, some of these teams don't have as good a sponsorship as like SK Telecom does. So the latest player, who I think will do very well in Korea, is Nooni. And he's a ProDOS player, also from USA. And he, if you want to watch a foreigner's perspective, he follows the Korean style of play very well because he plays a defensive style. And I think that's the very strong way to play right now against foreigners, especially as ProDOS. You play a defensive opening, and then you can exploit the Terran or the Zerg in the mid-game based on the map and the distances between your bases. So he's going to do very well in Korea. I believe he's on Team Istro right now. But he went there recently, I think a few weeks ago, maybe a month ago. So he's also very good to watch because you should watch some of his games against Idra in the World Cyber Games, which he showed that he was a very strong player and actually got his ticket to Korea from there. But I'll wrap up by saying that the evolution of StarCraft really has not stopped. It slowed down a bit. It went from a lot of offense to now more defensive play, especially on the ProDOS and Terran side, with expanding early on. But there's still a lot of strategies. Anthony was just telling me the other day about the Terran versus Zerg, kind of like a mech reborn build with early Vulture and so forth. So there's still a lot of room for this game to grow. And even though it's somewhat peaked in Korea as far as the industry for StarCraft goes, StarCraft 2 is coming soon as well. So another reason why a lot of foreigners are playing right now, so they get back into the game and kind of transfer those skills to StarCraft 2. So I don't know what Alan has planned for the last 30 minutes, but if there's any more questions or whatever, we can deal with them afterwards. And these are really good references for throughout the semester, because a lot of these players have different styles. And you might find that your style matches a player's style very closely, and you can imitate that player's style a lot more easily based on how fast you are or what you like to do in the game versus a certain race and so forth. So that is the history of StarCraft in like 25 minutes or so. Believe me, I could go on for hours, and I missed a lot of things. A lot of other good foreigners that went to Korea and had some success as well. But I'll hand it over to Alan, and he'll wrap this up here. And I just want to mention that feel free to come to me. I'll put my email up and so forth on the board later, so you guys can message me or whatever. And just going to do my best to help out Alan in this course in whatever way possible. Okay? Thanks, guys.
Before we move on to our next topic, I have something to give to people in this class. Alright. How many of you are very interested in the class and are complete noobs and you plan on coming for another 13 weeks?
Question,
yes.
Define complete noobs.
Do you know might be able to beat the computer on a good day. I'm trying to pick those at random. Wait, how come like 10 more hands just came up? Okay, good. Next. Who here is a D or D plus player and very interested in the class and you want to come.
Well, I have a question.
Question.
What if you don't play on IC Cup
play?
You can hear it.
8 p.m.
180,
200.
Alright. How much
is a player cost? Oh.
150. 150.
There you go, sir.
You notice your photos?
It's 10 pounds. Yeah, exactly. And wants to come. Stay.
Well, who knows the highest ranking on iCup? Who knows what it is? What's the symbol?
World Cup thing, right?
That's right.
Yeah,
right. We already have one.
Sorry. Sorry.
The guy with the white shirt in the back is the
Alright, so who else wants one?
What?
Let's see. You look interested. Two hands. There we go. Two hands.
Yeah.
And, wow, so I just saw a double the hands.
Trying to do something unique, you know.
Sleeping.
Congrats.
Well, that's the previews for now. Those are the... See, the thing is, I posted a while back that I've been giving out free raiders to everyone in the class, so I printed out 25. So, sorry I can't give everyone one. The readers are, again, at ZZ Copy. They'll be very useful. Alright. So now, let's get into a little bit about what we're actually going to be talking about for the rest of the semester. We've been going over stuff like history, like syllabus, like what StarCraft is, who plays StarCraft. When you get down to it, let's get down to the theory of it. Alright, so in the basics of every single endeavor you may ever choose to go on, there's a concept of resources, okay? And these resources, well, we assume to be one, limited, and two, can be fought for. As far as fighting for these resources go, you might have to fight against another person for these resources. You might have to fight against nature for these resources. Your hand might not be big enough. Your eyes might not be able to see enough. But you might have to fight someone for mineral, for gas, for territory. However, there's one resource in StarCraft that tops them all. Can anyone tell me that?
Time
is very good, but with all sorts of time, you still won't do anything. Anyone else?
Attention.
Attention, that's right. And of course, with attention, you can do any number of things. So that's when we get into the construct of StarCraft. Obviously, StarCraft, as you're all aware, has minerals and gas. Can anyone bring up any other resources that are within the construct of the game? Population, right. What you see in the top right-hand corner. And you never want those two numbers to be equal unless it says 200. But what else?
Land,
that's true, but that's not a part of StarCraft. StarCraft never says you need land. It says you need more minerals, you need more Vespian gas, that's true. But what else do you need?
Scouts.
You don't need a scout. I don't scout, ever.
Pilot
supply depot already covered under. Oh, popular, but. Sorry, I was thinking about something else. Can you guys see the board, by the way?
Yeah.
Sort of.
Yes.
Alright. Yes, use block.
Energy.
Energy for casting?
Unit.
Very nice. Energy. actually haven't had that.
Tech. Like the tech tree?
Yeah.
Sort of. We'll get to the assistant resources in a little bit. We're talking about physical resources for now. All right, I think I alluded to this earlier, but anyone think about buildings? Well, if you don't have buildings, you lose. So it too is a physical resource. So here's, I think, a pretty complete list of resources. Also, I like to increase power / creep. Of course, Terran players, you guys don't need either power or creep, but the rest of us need to have somewhere to put our buildings. Okay, so these we will entitle the physical resources. Now next is something that is not physical, something that you that might be in the game, but you can only think about, that's a concept, okay? I'm gonna start you off with, let's say, the concept of having an army. You can have units, but you don't have an army unless you know how to do with it. You have the concept of grouping units together. So these transformation resources, I call them, are things like army. What else? We're thinking about concepts here. Chris?
Morale.
Morale?
Yeah.
Your personal morale?
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to put that under physical resources, because that's something within the physical world, not in the Starcraft construct.
Sure.
Yes?
High ground.
High ground, yes, excellent. Positioning. Anything else?
Deception.
Deception is not a resource, it's an analytical thing.
Space,
territory, excellent. And I guess production facilities. And then I guess one more concept is macro. Okay, macro management, so to speak. The ability, the thought process behind creating more units. These we'll call transformation resources. Transformation resources. The reason why the transformation resources is because they transform something you have. Army transforms units into power. Positioning transforms the army into something greater. Territory transforms the economy. Yes, question back there in the blue.
I was just gonna say that I think one of the resources could also be like the ability to threaten something. Someone?
Definitely. That we'll talk about in a little bit. Okay, someone said morale. Who said morale? Morale is an excellent idea of something out of the game. Can anyone else think of anything outside of the game? I call these physical resources because they're in the physical world. What?
Stamina.
All right. Let's keep it closer to the game. I mean, yeah. You need air to breathe. I know. But something else that directly affects the game.
Speed.
APM. Yes. Your fingers can only move so fast. I played piano for like 12 years before I started StarCraft. My fingers are very fast. And I'm sure many of you grew up typing, and so we hope we all have fast fingers. So that's something very important to the game. It's a physical limitation that we must overcome, that we have to consider how we use each keystroke, that if we can only type so fast, if your fingers are only so big, if you can't reach from Z to 9 with an outstretched hand, you can't do certain things. You have to analyze your resources. That's a very excellent point. Anyone else? Green.
Reflexes,
excellent.
Where would like a strategy go?
Strategy, thinking, analysis. So that's what, someone brought up deception. I think analysis would definitely go under deception. It uses something you already have, but to use something outside the game to put into it, okay? Just a couple more things. Vision. I don't know about you, Terrence, but I can't see under Dark Swarm. Okay, so actual physical vision is actually really important to me. During my time when I played seriously, My eyes got so used to tracking moving objects, I could scroll the screen and see what's going on. I couldn't read books though, because I couldn't stare at stationary objects. How about practice time? How you choose to use your practice time? You can use your play your practice time playing UMSs, or like stop one unit, or you can practice something else altogether. Yes?
Yomi, which is the Japanese word for reading the mind of the opponent.
I actually don't know what that means, so I'm sorry I cannot elaborate on that.
I've written a whole book on it and designed a card game about it too, so.
Excellent.
You have the book.
Well, what you just mentioned is what happens in every single game that's played in the Pro League. It's like, how many of you have heard the term build order? Build order, right? I mean, everybody searches for the right build order, right? Like opening, how to start the game. And basically, when you become better, faster, have a better understanding of the game, build order becomes obsolete. It's just a tool for you. You no longer rely on it. In the Pro Leagues, it's the constant counter of build order. So, you know, Boxer opens this way, his opponent, Stork, reacts this way, and then Boxer does this, Stork does this, and so forth. So, in the end, you know, it's tough to track what each player does because they keep adapting. So, reading the opponent, trying to figure out what he's doing, is very important to start the game.
Also, I'm surprised no one's brought any of these up yet, but I call these assistant resources. Can anyone think of what that might mean? To give you an example, something like technology, the tech tree, would be an assistant resource. Does it do anything? Does having Sidestorm researched, or having Siege Mode researched, do anything? Having Lurkers researched, does it do anything physical? Nothing actually happens once this is researched. However, it gives you the ability to use what you have before. So we're going to list this as tech/upgrades. So these enhance something that has happened before. They'll enhance your army, enhance your macro, or whatever. Anyone else give me any examples of assistant?
Yes. Does scouting count?
Yes. Although scouting is heavily linked with analysis in Yomi. I'll be sure to read up on that. Yes.
Support units, medics, filers, things that don't actually.
Well, technically, they still do something. They occupy physical space in the game.
Yeah.
So they're still part of the physical construct of the game. I mean, the assistant resources, they're definitely physical constructs of the game, but you won't see their effects manifested until you actually apply them to some other resource. Anyone else?
The unit combinations are very important.
Yes, definitely. We'll get to that in the future list.
I think I cut somebody off who was just about to speak.
Yes. Defensive and offensive upgrades, especially the whole, plasma shielding and protoss?
Yes.
A while, so I don't
building placement. All right, I'm going to expand on that. That's
what you meant to say, right?
Oh, sorry. Sorry, go on. Yes.
Go with that.
All right.
You said, what about upgrades in the sense of plasma shields for Protoss buildings? How does that come into play?
Well, those upgrades will actually span many different things. For example, they'll span the army. They'll span the units themselves. None of these resources are limited to any specific task. As we'll discuss in just a few minutes, these are completely interchangeable, and it's their transformation, it's their change between everything that makes these the analysis of these resources so important. But placement and upgrades, placement, not just of buildings, but also of units. So. So we have units and if you've read the reader or you're gonna read the reader, we have the concept of stances. These stances tell you how the placement really affects everything in the game. So even though it's just something purely thought, purely in your thoughts, not in the concept of the game, having good placement will definitely help. Yes.
How about terrain advantages? Like if you have a ramp that you've taken or a choke.
if you don't use it, then it's of no good.
Exactly. We'll get to utilization of resources as well. Yes.
But how about fangirls?
They don't do anything. Actually, bullfighters claim that they fight better after having sex. So that's, I think that's something StarCraft players could protect against. It makes their eyes more accurate, something like that. But it may just say they're more sex, I don't know. Alright, since we're running a little low on time, I'm gonna finish up the rest of this. We have micromanagement. The concept of micromanagement, although the actual implementation of this micromanagement is firmly within the realm of attention and APM. And this shall be titled Assistant Resources. So, you have all these resources. What do you plan on doing with them? Well, remember when we went back to earlier today, we talked about the most important resource of all, buildings. So you have to transform all your resources into something that will destroy your opponent's buildings. Although in reality, what this means is spending attention, because attention is the most basic of our resources. So what you have to analyze is which resources can transform into which other resources by using which transformation resource. Okay? You have to analyze which resource transforms into which other resource. I mean, granted, most of the time it's going to be APM when buildings and minerals transforms into an army. That's going to be most of it, okay? But like we said before, like if you have no reflexes, can you compensate for your lack of reflexes, your lack of your physical resource by using some other method? For instance, let's suppose you're not fast enough. All right, let's say you're 70 APM and you just can't. You can't pay attention to everything on the map. Your scouting's not good enough. I'm sorry, it's not. What can we do? Well, you can notice that you can use your macro management and your buildings and minerals can suffer a little to save your reflexes. For instance, if you're worried about drops, if you put three, let's say, cannons, turrets, mines, lurkers, or whatever behind your mineral line or around your base, you've essentially used up some of your economic resource in order to help your reflexes. And also, let's suppose that you don't have population. You get to 131 population, and you're like, oh crap, I'm 131 out of 131. What do? Well, you know that your population resource is capped out, is maxed out at this very moment. However, how can you do something with it? Well, you can spend your population resource by putting it into army using micromanagement and micromanagement to decrease the resources of someone else's, let's say, territory, for instance. You make an attack. That's a very, very fancy way of making an attack. But you have to understand that making an attack is, in fact, using some resources transforming to other resources. We've also, you brought up, it was very nice, that that upgrades, like plasma shields, can have multiple uses. It upgrades the army and it upgrades buildings, it upgrades your placement. So you have to in your mind at least, come up with a complex web of which resources depend on which. And although, I mean, like I said before, a lot of these things you can't do in the game, but what you can do is you can say like, you say, okay, I have plenty of this resource and this resource and this resource right now. How can I use it best to transform into something? Of course, that's something you have to understand your purpose. And we're not ready to talk about purpose at such a deep level yet. But you just have to understand that resources can be transformed.
I'm just noting that you have physical resources twice. And
yeah.
Oh
crap.
Can you just physical limitations or something?
Thank you for catching that.
Real life.
Raw resources. Resources that the construct of the game actually recognizes. So, about something interesting about the, we've already discussed the assistant resources, how they don't actually do anything unless you work on them, unless you use them. So, someone brought up a very interesting point. What if you take a high ground, a choke point, and you don't use it? Well, what have you spent in order to achieve that high ground? Well, you may have spent attention. You might have spent units in the form of units not attacking at any particular moment. You might have spent minerals to put cannons on top of a ramp. But, and so you have to think about then what you get out of it. Well, you get stopping opponents scouting. I don't think a drone can make it up past like four cannons or anything. You get, what do you else get out of it?
Vision.
You get vision. You get vision. You know that for a part of the map, you know that nothing is there except what you have.
Territory.
Exactly, territory. That's part of it too. But you have to understand that. I mean, maybe it's after the game. Maybe it's a split second decision during the game. But you have to understand what have I spent and what have I gained. If you, like I said before, if you research Sidestorm, don't make any high Templar. You've just wasted resources. You've wasted valuable minerals and gas that could have gone to, let's say, making another gateway and another high Templar. It's a perfectly great use of resources. So you have to, both before, during, and after the game, understand what is the purpose of this resource, what is the purpose of this further transformation. One last note about transformation resources is that transformation resources always take time. You've got time, right? Time is something very, very valuable to all of us. Not just in attention, but actual physical time. I guess that's something that's that should go under raw resource because the computer does recognize the concept of time. So you have to understand that you can't turn your minerals into territory immediately. But what you have to understand is the route that your minerals take. Your minerals become barracks. Your barracks become units. Your units utilize attention. Your attention gives you territory. You have to analyze whether or not it's worth it, and in game you have to plan ahead. You can't say, oh crap, I wish I had an army right now. And oh, what's this? 5,000 minerals? Oh man, I don't need more minerals. So you should have planned out a while ago to build 6 more hatcheries or 18 more pairs of zerglings. Okay. So that's this is part of the lecture, but this is also an overview of the kind of stuff we'll be going over in the future. It's going to be more raw theory. It's not. It's going to have practical applications, but only if you think very hard to apply it. Thank you for coming to the first lecture. I hope.